Welcome back. We have been discussing a number of toxins and chemicals and issues related to toxicology in the previous episodes. And in this particular episode, we will look at a controversial topic that is to do with a substance of abuse. But before that, let me bring greetings to all of you from the Poison Control Center at Cochin, where we have a 24-hour poison information service and an accredited analytical toxicology laboratory that has been functioning in an uninterrupted manner for the last 17 years. We move on to the topic on hand, and that is weed. We need to talk about weed and weed out a lot of misconceptions. There is a lot of controversy today because of a sensational kind of investigation that is going on in India related to our film industry and some others. Not going into the details because that is not the focus of our talk, of our discussion. The focus is with regard to this term, weed, as to what it means, what are the medical and legal and social connotations. So let's ask, first of all, this question: what exactly is weed? Sometimes a person uses terms like this without really understanding the meaning. In common terms, weed refers to some unwanted or undesirable kind of plant that usually interferes with other more desirable plants in a garden or maybe among crops in agriculture. So we use the term weed for unwanted a plant. That is common usage. But when you use the term weed in slang, it means a completely different thing altogether. We are talking about cannabis. When you say weed in slang, what you are referring to is this particular plant. And this has in fact become a kind of generic term that includes a number of chemicals, will come to that, or preparations, and therefore do not confuse cannabis as being distinct from the plant. It is almost like synonyms. Cannabis, the generic term which comprises a number of preparations from the plant, as also the plant itself. Will come to the species name a little later. The images here show you the various ways by which this particular substance, cannabis, is consumed, and the central image shows you the plant itself, the plants and the distinctive kinds of leaves. So right out, let me tell you that cannabis is one of the classical drugs or substances of abuse that have existed not only in India but in almost every part of the world from times immemorial. So these are the details with regard to the plant. Botanical name, Cannabis sativa, Cannabis indica. There is a little bit of controversy as to whether there are really differences between the two, or they actually refer to the same, you know, plant. The similarities are so much. And while Cannabis sativa is called as such in some countries and Cannabis indica in some other countries, botanists are a little confused as to what exactly is the difference, except for the fact that the location is different. Physically, if you look at the plant, it's actually a herb, though it is very tall, grows up to 10 to 15 feet in height. And it is important to emphasize here that the terms, you know, like herb or shrub or tree, sometimes can be misleading. There are trees which are very short, shrubs which are quite huge, and herbs which are quite tall, like cannabis. Another distinctive aspect of cannabis is that it's a dioecious plant. That is, the sexes are separate. So you have male plants and you have female plants. And like many other things in nature, the female plant is more potent than the male. I think I may mention that this is true of even creatures or animals. And there are several species where we find the female of the species is more potent than the male. But then that's a different topic of discussion altogether. And we will move on to the other aspects of cannabis. And very important to know that there are some active principles in cannabis that are responsible mainly for the mind-altering properties and also some other kinds of properties. We'll come to that later. The main active principle is what is referred to as delta-9-tetrahydrocannabinol, often shortened to THC, abbreviated to just THC. There are some other active principles. We'll come to that later. The highest concentration of active principles usually seen in flowering tops of the plant, especially the female plant, and they are also sometimes referred to as bracts or inflorescences. Active principles are also present in other parts of the plant, including the leaves, stem and root, virtually all parts. Only thing is the concentration may differ or may vary from part to part. This image shows you the important species of cannabis that is encountered usually. The commonest is sativa, pretty tall plant. Then you have indica, and finally the least common is ruderalis. There is also an image showing the differences in the leaves between indica and sativa, and you can see the leaves are slightly broader in the case of indica, while they are slender and not so broad as in the case of indica with regard to sativa. These images are just to indicate to you the basic differences, but when we talk of cannabis, we talk of generally this kind of, you know, image that we commonly see when we go to the net and, you know, type out cannabis. This is what we see, the leaves which are very nicely, you know, colored green, very bright green, and the typical kind of slight or gentle serrations of the edges of the leaves, maybe among the most widely known kinds of images with regard to leaves in the world that you can imagine. Alright, coming to preparations of cannabis, by which this particular substance is abused much of the time, and while there are some uses for this plant, we'll come to that later, and often that is overshadowed by the abuse. So first of all, marijuana. It may be spelt with J or H, but it's always pronounced marijuana. The J is never pronounced or emphasized, not marijuana. But the slang can be Mary Jane. And in India, often we refer to this as ganja, which is also the same as pot or weed or grass. So now you have it. This is the origin of the term weed. Weed refers to marijuana, which is one very common preparation of cannabis. And much of the time, this particular preparation refers to dried flowering tops which have been crushed and which can be smoked in a pipe called a chillum, or more commonly in the form of a cigarette. And in slang, you call that a reefer or joint. Then you have a powerful preparation called charas in India and hashish in the Gulf and hash in the West, all referred to the same. It's a kind of resin which you obtain from various parts of the plant, maybe the flowering tops, maybe the leaves or stem, and contains high concentration of active principles. Then you have bhang, which is pretty common in India, and it's a decoction of dried leaves and stem which can be mixed with various kinds of drinks or beverages, even in the form of tea or in the form of a soft, you know, drink or juice. All kinds of variations are there, and bhang is quite commonly consumed, especially during certain festivals in India. Then there is a sweetmeat that is prepared with the extract from the plant, often called majun. And there is a seedless variety of marijuana, which is not very common in India. So these are the common preparations, and I've given you some of the slang names also, and now you know as to what exactly weed means. It is the same as marijuana or ganja, and you can also call that grass or pot. These images show you the bud of the plant, the inflorescence, which has been, you know, processed to make it in the form of a reefer or joint that I referred to earlier, where it is, you know, crushed and then rolled in paper, usually cigarette paper, and then lighted up for smoking. This is one of the commonest modes of intake of cannabis. You also have different other preparations, like the ones shown on this image. The blocks that you see are hashish, also called hash. It's a resin that has been, you know, processed, ready for sale, of course illegal. And then you also have in the lower half of the image the infamous hash oil, which should not be confused with CBD oil, which is very much in the news today. CBD is different. It stands for cannabidiol, and it is an active principle that actually does not have any kind of euphoric effects that are associated with the other active principle, that is THC, tetrahydrocannabinol. And these images show you bhang, which is, you know, in the glass, you know, tumbler. And this is one form of bhang. There are various other kinds. I told you it can be the form of a variety of beverages, and it can also be in the form of tea that is usually consumed in the West. That is a kind of a herbal tea and supposed to be beneficial. That's what people claim, though there are a lot of controversies about that. And then there is the sweetmeat also shown here, and that is often referred to as majun, where the extract of cannabis is mixed with it. Let us now look at the medico-social and medico-legal aspects of cannabis. We'll also look at some of the purely medical aspects a little later. Let it be very clear that cannabis is one of the most common substances of abuse in the world. It is said to be, in fact, the most common illegal substance abused in the world. When we look at all the substances put together, including legal substances like alcohol and tobacco, cannabis comes down. We refer to these three as the unholy trinity, because much of substance abuse around the world involved one or more of these three. But alcohol and tobacco are permissible in many parts of the world, though there are areas where, you know, one or the other is prohibited, but most parts of the world say that tobacco and alcohol are permissible. But almost, you know, most parts of the world say that cannabis cannot be permissible. In fact, it should be banned. And it is, in fact, banned in many countries of the world. So we need to ask some questions here. If cannabis is a banned substance, why are tobacco and alcohol not banned? Or you can put it another way. If tobacco and alcohol are not banned substances, why is cannabis banned? In other words, is cannabis more harmful than alcohol and tobacco? As doctors, we know that tobacco is among the deadliest substances known to man, which has been abused for centuries. It has almost nil by way of medical uses. Alcohol, yes, also extremely hazardous, but at least there are some indications it may be beneficial in small quantities. And cannabis also almost in the same class. Hazardous, no doubt, but does have some medical uses. So why have you separated cannabis from the unholy trinity? Shouldn't you be treating it the same as alcohol and tobacco? And if you're going to ban cannabis, should you not be considering banning alcohol and tobacco also? And if you are permitting the use of alcohol and tobacco, why have you banned cannabis? Let us look at the answers, or at least attempt to answer, in the form of a very objective discussion. I refer to the active principles in cannabis. I told you there are mainly two, delta 9 tetrahydrocannabinol, called or usually referred to as THC, the abbreviated form, and then you have cannabidiol, CBD. Both are cannabinoids. Cannabinoids are the active principles of cannabis, and there are a vast number of them. There are, whether believe it or not, dozens, maybe even hundreds of cannabinoids, of which these two are the most important. And even here, there is a very significant difference. THC or tetrahydrocannabinol is psychoactive, whereas CBD, that is cannabidiol, is not psychoactive. In fact, CBD does not give you a high when you consume it. It has a lot of medical properties, and I don't know why the media is out to tarnish CBD as some sort of a dangerous substance. It is available in prescription form in some countries where medical cannabis is sold. And whether you believe it or not, even THC is sold in the form of a medical or pharmaceutical preparation in some countries of the world. A lot of wrong information being bandied about, especially in the current scenario of this case that is going on in India, and the media is pouncing on all kinds of information and projecting those as truth. And we need to be very clear that there is a lot that is untrue in what is being discussed in the media, both social media and the mainstream media. When you look at THC versus CBD, these are the important points to remember. Both CBD and THC have the exact same molecular structure, and only a slight difference in how the atoms are arranged accounts for the differing effects on the body. In other words, CBD is not psychoactive, as mentioned already, and does not produce the high associated with THC. CBD has been in fact shown to be beneficial in the treatment of disorders like depression, anxiety and seizures. And in 2018, the US Food and Drug Administration, US FDA, approved Epidiolex, a prescription medication containing CBD. There are other kinds of medications approved not just by the US but several other countries in the world, especially Europe. We'll come to that a little later. With regard to the medical aspects, it is certainly true that cannabis in general, when you look at its use or abuse, is a euphoriant. And much of that comes from, as I've already emphasized, THC, not really from CBD. So if you use cannabis in the various kinds of preparations that I listed earlier, you can get these effects: euphoria, altered state of mind and sense of time, that is disorientation, there may be difficulty in concentration, impaired short-term memory and body movement, sometimes leading to incoordination, almost as if the person is drunk. And so very dangerous to use cannabis and then operate machinery or drive a vehicle, just as in the case of alcohol. Cannabis is also supposed to cause relaxation and increase in appetite, which are considered its beneficial effects. All these effects last for about 2 to 6 hours, depending on the amount used and the mode of intake. In high doses, there are unpleasant manifestations, beginning with anxiety and progressing to delusions, hallucinations, panic and paranoia as far as the mental effects are concerned, which can be very disturbing. Aside from physical effects like increased heart rate or tachycardia, there may also be difficulty in breathing, that is respiratory difficulty, and there can also be nausea, sometimes vomiting, and eyes are often red. That's a distinctive feature of cannabis abuse, reddening of the eyes. More than pupillary constriction or dilatation, this is more important. And it is well known that long-term abuse, especially excessive amounts over a prolonged period of time, can give rise to impairment of cognitive functions, leading to what we call the amotivational syndrome, where a person becomes very lethargic, demotivated to do anything, and he just sits and is in a dreamy state. He is disinclined to move or to study or to work. There is a kind of a feeling of well-being, but drowsy and inert kind of well-being, and the person becomes unproductive, and that's the main problem with regard to cannabis. It can cause a person sometimes disinclined to work, so productivity may be affected, and this is covered by the term amotivational syndrome. In a few cases, there may be exacerbation of an underlying psychosis which is already present in the individual, and he goes berserk, what we call run amok, kind of acute psychosis. But whether cannabis produces this on its own is controversial. There are also indications that cannabis smoking especially can cause lung problems, especially chronic bronchitis, and cannabis use during pregnancy associated with some real problems to do with fetal development and even some postnatal risk of cancer, though these are more or less hypothesis right now, more than proved, you know, kind of problems. The question has to be asked, does cannabis have any medical uses? And this is how it is. This is the truth. In 2018, just recently, the US FDA approved a preparation called Epidiolex, which contains CBD. And whether you believe it or not, another preparation called Dronabinol, which contains THC, has been available by prescription for several years in the US, more than 10 years. It is well known that cannabis does have some medical uses, and some of these points are taken from what the World Health Organization has said, and that is that medical preparations of cannabis can be greatly helpful in nausea and vomiting in advanced stages of cancer and AIDS. Also, very strong indications that cannabis is helpful in the treatment of asthma and glaucoma. It can also be used as an antidepressant. It is a well-known appetite stimulant, and cannabis preparations have also been used with beneficial effect in various kinds of epilepsy. So it's an anticonvulsant and is also beneficial as an antispasmodic for muscle spasms. So these are all medical indications. Several of them have been proved in controlled studies, though I admit more research is required before we can say for 100% sure that there is no significant adverse effects and that these preparations are quite safe. That is why maybe India has so far not moved to legalize even medical forms of cannabis. This particular image shows a person who went by the name of Mr. Nice. It's an alias. His actual name, Howard Marks. He was notorious in the 1980s and even earlier as one of the biggest smugglers of cannabis of all time. And you will not believe it, Mr. Nice or Mr. Marks was a scholar in Oxford University. He's a Welshman, and he got a scholarship to Oxford, and there unfortunately he went into drugs and later on into peddling of drugs and finally smuggling, and became one of the kingpins. And when we say kingpin, we are talking of tons of cannabis being smuggled across international borders. When we refer to terms like drug cartel, drug mafia, terms which are loosely being, you know, applied in the current scenario by various news channels and news media, we have to be very clear about the meaning. We are talking about kilograms, hundreds, maybe thousands, when we look at you know, smuggling in such a mega manner, only then we use terms like a mafia or cartel. And I'm amused that some news channels are using these terms without understanding, you know, the implication, when all that we have come across so far is seizure in the form of a few grams, maybe maximum a few hundred grams. And I don't know as to how you can start talking about drug mafia and drug nexus involving elite, you know, kinds of people who are totally addicted and behaving in a very bizarre manner, all kinds of things that are being highlighted in the media. I think it's more a kind of inflation than anything else, blowing something out of proportion. And one should be watching, for instance, this film, Mr. Nice, to know what this man, Howard Marks, did. This is films actually based on the book which came out earlier, which was his autobiography. He was finally caught by the US somewhere, I think, in the late 1980s or early 1990s. He was in prison for about 7 years. Finally, he was released, and after that only he brought out this book. I think this came out in 1997. The book was adapted into film in early 2000s. And both are very, very popular indeed, and gives you the complete picture of what Howard Marks did and his activism for cannabis, saying that, you know, actually I'm doing nothing wrong. I may be smuggling, according to people, something that is harmful, but according to me, it is not as harmful as people believe, maybe not even as harmful as tobacco. That's what he claimed. And much of what he said in those years are now slowly coming true. As I said, there are now medical forms of cannabis that are being legalized by various countries, and even scientists and doctors are moving towards decriminalizing cannabis and not, you know, demonizing it all the time like, you know, it has been done so many years in so many countries. So if you look at the countries which have decriminalized to some extent, and some of those countries which have completely legalized cannabis, this is the list. Colombia and Cambodia, de facto legal. In fact, Colombia is one of the countries involved in large-scale smuggling of cannabis, as also many other South American countries and some Asian and African countries also. Then you have countries like Australia, Chile, Germany, Greece, Israel, Italy, the Netherlands, Peru, Poland, Mexico, Sri Lanka, and the UK, where there are legal forms of cannabis and that have been approved for medical use. Countries like Spain and Jamaica, partly legal, though I don't really know exactly what that means. In India, bhang is legal in some states and maybe most parts of the country during some festivals, which is paradoxical because bhang is a cannabis, and cannabis is a banned substance as per the NDPS Act, Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act. So there is a bit of confusion here. In Nepal, our neighboring country, it is fully legal during Mahashivaratri, and fully legal even for recreational purpose in countries like the Netherlands, South Africa, Canada, Georgia, and Uruguay. I think put it the other way around. Uruguay is the first country to fully legalize cannabis. Cannabis is now being fully legalized in several states of the US also, and they are listed here, including Alaska, California, Colorado, Illinois, Maine, Massachusetts, Michigan, Nevada, Oregon, Vermont, Washington, and the District of Columbia. And I believe that more and more states are following suit in the US. Having said all that, with regard to India, one needs to emphasize once again, cannabis is banned as per the NDPS Act, even though paradoxically, bhang, one of the preparations, is legal in many areas and consumed quite openly and freely, especially during certain festivals and in the vicinity of some religious places. This image shows you that some of these places which sell these kinds of preparations, in fact, are being authorized by the government. You have the board here saying government authorized bhang shop. How do you like that? We will close by looking at this because there is some confusion. There are a number of substances which are now available on the net, widely being bandied about as cannabinoids. They are synthetic substances and not to be confused with the cannabinoids that I have been talking about so far. These are dangerous substances. They are not really found in cannabis plant, though they bind to the same receptors in the body. And there are some examples I mentioned here, very strange kinds of names, and some of them are sold under attractive brand names like Spice. Studies have shown that these kinds of substances are quite hazardous and should not be taken lightly at all. They are not like the other genuine cannabinoids or the natural cannabinoids and can cause severe psychotic episodes just within days after use, and some have even caused mortality. Sometimes, some of the cases we have seen mortality. So synthetic cannabinoids like the one shown here is available on the net. Be very careful, very dangerous. Not to be confused with cannabis. There is no controversy here, whereas there is some controversy with regard to natural cannabinoids. And that brings us to the end of the presentation. It is up to you all to consider as to whether we should continue to ban cannabis outright as we have been doing, or whether we should move towards decriminalizing. I'm not saying fully legalizing, but decriminalizing the use of cannabis, at least for certain indications, under restrictions. And recreational use, of course, I don't think that is going to happen in the near future in India. I don't think the government will be interested in even considering that prospect, though, as I've already, you know, talked about in the lecture, there are so many other countries that have fully legalized cannabis, both medically and for recreational purposes also. So I leave you to think and ponder, but at the same time, please do not outright condemn this particular substance of abuse, which I feel should be bracketed along with substances like tobacco and alcohol. That is, substances which, if you want to permit the use, there should be restrictions, and there should not be any kind of discrimination between the three, because that is kind of irrational. So that is all from me and the Indian Society of Toxicology. Keep watching. Please do subscribe to the channel. You'll be notified whenever we put up videos like this, and we do this quite regularly for the benefit of medical students mainly, as also doctors and even the common man. Thank you and goodbye.